You're watching Brain Power, Carotid Artery Disease on ABC 27, brought to you by Penn State Milton S. Hershey Medical Center.
And welcome back, Dr. Halbaugh. Now, if medication itself doesn't work, what are some of the options for treating this disease?
Well, in addition to the medical management, you can treat carotid artery disease with invasive procedures, including angioplasty and stenting or carotid endarterectomy.
All right, let's start with the first two options. You mentioned angioplasty, stenting. People hear about that, they think of the heart and so on. Talk about that. What's that mean in this case?
It's a similar procedure to what is done for coronary arteries. A catheter is placed usually in the femoral artery in the leg, and then it's worked up through the arteries, through the abdomen and chest, and into the carotid artery. At the area of narrowing, a balloon is inflated to open up the vessel, and a stent, a metal cylinder, is put in there to help keep the vessel open.
What are the risks with this kind of procedure?
The risks of this kind of procedure carry the risks of any invasive surgical type procedure, bleeding and infection, and there's also a risk of stroke. Because people with carotid artery disease may also have coronary artery disease, the stress of the procedure may cause a heart attack.
You talked about a procedure. I want to make sure I get this carotid endarterectomy procedure. How do those risks compare to the angioplasty and, forgive me, the first one?
Angioplasty and stenting. Yeah.
How do they compare?
Well, I think there have been a number of good studies coming out both in North America and in Europe that indicate that the stroke risk with carotid endarterectomy is a bit lower than the stroke risk with angioplasty and stenting. The most recent study that came out suggested that the cardiac risks from endarterectomy were higher than they were for angioplasty and stenting.
Now, I find this fascinating that the patients are awake for this surgery. That's just somehow, if I'm lying on a table, that sounds unnerving.
Right. Well, both procedures can be done either with a general or local anesthesia. I've done all of my carotid surgery with a local anesthesia since 1992, and I think there's a benefit to that on reducing the risk to the heart and lungs, and we also have an awake patient that we can monitor minute to minute regarding his neurological status. Patients are numbed up so it doesn't hurt. They can't see the incision. And most people initially don't like the idea of awake surgery, but come back to the clinic saying, I'm glad I did it that way.
That's good to hear. All right, well, thank you, Doctor. And Deborah Pinkerton, she's here now to tell us about another patient who had this procedure. Deborah?
Chuck, our next story is about a Lebanon County man who was ready to enjoy Christmas last year, but instead spent most of the holiday in the hospital. 81-year-old Seth Hoosman is a pretty good pool player.
Five ball in the corner.
One by one, he sinks them. The balls fall so easily into the pockets. And last December, it was Seth who fell so easily onto the floor at St. Andrew's Presbyterian Church.
We had gone to church on Christmas Eve with the idea of participating in the choir. As we were proceeding to the choir room, there's a coat rack, and I stop at the coat rack to hang up my coat, and that's just simply the last thing that I remember.
One of the gentlemen in the choir came over and very calmly said, "Now, don't get upset, but Seth is out in the hall on the floor." So I went out there, and there he was, and unable to find words, and scared me half to death.
Seth had a stroke. He spent several days at a local hospital and went home, but not for long.
I was sitting there at the dining room table right after dinner, and suddenly my speech powers sort of disappeared, and my son and daughter looked at me and said, "Dad, you're crashing."
His face had kind of sagged, and he was again not only finding it difficult to form a word, but he just wasn't able to speak.
This time, Seth went to Penn State Hershey Neuroscience Institute. An MR angiogram revealed the problem.
Here are the carotid arteries coming up. You can see these vessels are both quite robust. On this side, right at this spot, there's almost no
flow through here. You can see it reconstitute farther down, but this is a very, very narrow vessel, and this is the source of his stroke.
In order to for me to really return to a lot of activity, you know, to really be able to keep on going, it was his judgment that they needed to open the artery.
He said, I think he's a perfect candidate for this, and I think he should have it right away. And so did we, so I wasn't one bit hesitant about doing it.
On New Year's Eve, Dr. Robert Harbaugh performed the surgery.
I was so glad to see him come in and give me that good sign that everything was okay. And
I think it's important, you know, to go find the family as soon as you're done, because they're sitting there chewing their nails to the quick, waiting for information.
He explained everything and how well he had come through the surgery and that he should be okay. And those are the words I was waiting for.
The doctor told me I was going to be fine. I had high hopes that he was right, and he was.
This is the kind of guy who's probably going to be going strong at 90. The fact that he could get back to doing all the things he wanted to do right away was important for him.
He's doing so well. I hardly see any difference in him now than before the stroke. I really can't say that he has changed very much.
I think I probably feel better. I didn't know it at the time, but I probably feel better now than I did before, because like I say, I eat better and exercise more. I'm enjoying life.
And as you could see, Seth is enjoying life. He tells me that the only residual effects from the strokes, his right fingers are numb, but that's it. He's doing great, Chuck.
I'll tell you, it looks great too. I think that 90 is a pretty good bet too. Now, doctor, both these patients, stories we saw tonight, they use surgery to correct a problem. How do you decide what is the best treatment?
Well, deciding what's the best treatment for any individual patient, medical treatment alone, angioplasty and stenting or endarterectomy, is really a complicated and individualized decision, and it needs to take into account the risks of the disease in that patient, as well as the risks and benefits of the procedures that can be used to treat it. And for both stenting and surgery, the skill of the operator is a very important piece.
Always a skill. And how long would these patients be in the hospital after the treatment? What's the typical time frame?
Nearly everybody goes home the next day, and they can usually resume almost all of their usual activities when they go home.
Well, thank you, doctor. And let's see what new viewer questions are coming in the call center. Deborah?
Thanks, Chuck. We do have some more viewer questions. This is the next one. What is the difference between a TIA and a stroke?
A TIA, this actually stands for transient ischemic attack, and this is a temporary event where a blood vessel going to the brain becomes temporarily blocked. That blockage then results in some temporary dysfunction, so numbness, weakness, or paralysis, but that gets better. Now, usually this happens and it gets better in about an hour, sometimes maybe as long as 24 hours. On the other hand, a stroke is an event that occurs that's permanent, where the brain tissue actually dies and does not recover, and you're left with some sort of permanent deficit, such as, again, numbness, weakness, or paralysis.
Either way, you should go to the doctor immediately.
Absolutely. A TIA is actually a good warning sign for a stroke, and you actually recover completely. But yes, if you get to medical attention soon, then that can give you the best opportunity for getting better, most interventions that are available.
Okay, this is our next question. I'm 70 years old and have a 78% blockage in my carotid artery. At what percent blockage should I have treatment done?
So this is a difficult question somewhat. We kind of divide carotid artery stenosis into a couple of categories. People that have symptoms when they have a narrowed artery and people that don't have symptoms. If you have no symptoms and your artery is narrowed more than about 80%, then that's probably something that ought to be treated. It used to be a lower number than that, but now medicines are so much better that we probably don't need to treat ones that are less than 80%. On the other hand, if you have symptoms, well, then you probably ought to have your artery, or consider having your artery treated, even if it's narrower than 50%.
Okay, great. Thanks so much, Dr. Cockcroft. We'll be checking back with you. But right now, we'll send it to a break.